Clipper Audio presents an unabridged recording of Killing Rommel by Stephen Pressfield, narrated by Alfred Molina and directed by Claudia Howard. This book is copyrighted 2008 by Stephen Pressfield. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. What follows is a work of fiction, but its basis in reality is fact. All details of the trucks and tanks, geography, campaigns, battles, equipment, weapons, and nomenclature are historically accurate. All military units are real, with the exception of the T-3 Patrol and the Regiment of 22nd Armored Brigade, which are inventions. Where actual historical characters appear, among the more prominent, Jake Eisensmith, Paddy Maine, Nick Wilder, and Ron Tinker, all actions they are said to perform are exactly as the real individuals performed them. It is the summer of 1942, and Hitler's legions have swept across Europe. France has fallen. Churchill and the English are isolated on their island. In North Africa, Rommel and his panzers have routed the British Eighth Army and stand poised to overrun Egypt, Suez, and the oil fields of the Middle East. With the outcome of the war hanging in the balance, the British decide to launch a desperate plan. And now, Killing Rommel.
When my dad died, his closest friend came forward as a mentor and surrogate father to me. This was not without its challenges, since Chap, his full name was R. Lawrence Chapman, lived in England, while my family's home was in Manhattan. Chap's profession was publishing, so he got to New York regularly on business. I remember him taking me to the Milrose Games at Madison Square Garden every winter, in the days when the indoor track and field events were held in an arena so dense with cigarette smoke that you could barely see from one side to the other. Summers, I visited Chap and his wife Rose in London, and at Rose's brother Jock's cottage at Golspie in Scotland. Chap and Rose had an adopted daughter, Jessica, who was exactly my age, and two sons, Patrick and Tom, a couple of years older. The four of us were inseparable. Chap had lost his own parents when he was quite young, so he was sensitive to the needs of a boy without a father. He took me trekking and fly fishing. He taught me how to brew a cup of tea and how to write a declarative sentence. Chap was quite a celebrated editor and publisher. It was not unusual to find writers like Harold Pinter and John Osborne sitting down to supper. Chap was also, though he never talked about it, a war hero. He had won a DSO for his service in North Africa during World War II. DSO stands for Distinguished Service Order. The only British decoration higher is the Victoria Cross, the equivalent to our Medal of Honor. I was too young to understand much of this then, but I was impressed all the same. I remember Rose showing me a photo album once at their flat in Knightsbridge. There was Rose, circa 1939, looking as glamorous as Jean Tierney in Laura, and young Lieutenant Chapman, as dashing as Tyrone Power. I squinted at yellowing snapshots of youthful Englishmen and New Zealanders of Chap's unit, the Long Range Desert Group, posing beside wilderness-rigged trucks armed with 30-caliber Brownings and twin 303 Vickers K machine guns. You could see the sand channels mounted on the vehicle's flanks, perforated steel tracks that the men use for extricating trucks stuck in the soft sand. Rose said that such patrols routinely crossed hundreds, even thousands of miles of waterless, petrolless desert, where there was no mercy and no hope of rescue if anything went wrong. Sometime in the early 70s, Chap began writing a memoir of this experience. I was 11 or 12 then. I remember Chap sending Jessica and me to the Public Record Office in Chancery Lane to look up Army records for him. The documents had only recently become declassified. There was a stamp on the first page of each that read, "Most secret till 1972. Jessica and I got 5 pence apiece from Chap for copying these papers, which was big money in those days. Chap worked at home in his study, a tiny cubby littered with his war journals and diaries, correspondence with former comrades, maps of North Africa, and operations reports in English and German. I was fascinated. I plagued Chap with question after question, most of which he was patient enough to answer. It was not till the early 90s, however, when I became a historian myself, that my thoughts returned seriously to Chap's memoirs. I was visiting him and Rose in Scotland. Chap and I were playing the Strewy golf course, next door to Royal Dornoch. I asked what had happened with the document. It was in a drawer at home, Chap said. He had finished it, but never shown it to anyone except Rose. I asked if I could see it. No, it's a mess. Besides, I can't publish it. Chap expressed a number of reservations, largely about the personal nature of the material. He feared, he said, causing pain to the still-living widows and grown children of the men whose deaths he described in his pages. I could see that his own grief was deep and keenly felt. Still, as a writer, you can't let stuff like that stop you. And Chap knew it. Can you at least tell me what the book's about? It's not even a book, just, I don't know, an account.
Of what?
Nothing, really. One patrol, not even a successful one. I managed to drag out of Chap that the operation's objective had been to locate and kill Field Marshal Erwin Rommel, the legendary Desert Fox. Now I was really hooked. I pressed Chap to show me a few pages. He wouldn't budge. I accused him of being a chicken writer. He was exhibiting, I said, all the symptoms of publication terror that he always told me his own writers showed.
Come on, Chap, you can't be tough on them while letting yourself off the hook.
They're professional writers, he said. I'm not. Back in the States, I found myself unable to let go of curiosity about Chap's story. I began researching the era. The long-range desert group, I discovered, was one of the first of those units that would come to be called Special Forces. It had been based in Cairo and at various oases in the Libyan desert. Its missions were raiding and reconnaissance behind enemy lines against the Italians and Rommel's Africa Corps. The LRDG was small and secret. Rommel himself had declared that man for man, it had done more damage to the Axis cause than any other outfit in the North African campaign. On August 31st, 2002, Chap had a heart attack. He was okay. He recovered quickly. But on Christmas Day, 2 years later, he had another. I flew over. I was getting worried. Rose never left Chap's side. 3 nights after Christmas, Chap took her hand. He said he didn't think he would see the new year. By 10:15, he was gone. The funeral was at Magdalen College, Oxford. I was amazed at the turnout. Over 400 mourners filled the cloister, including 3 Booker Prize winners, all of whom Chap had either edited or published. The morning before I had left New York, a parcel had arrived from Rose. She wrote, "Chap wanted you to have this. He said he won't be a chicken writer anymore." It was the manuscript. I read it on the flight over, then twice again over the next 3 days. You have to be careful when you take in something like that, to evaluate it objectively and not get carried away by the emotion of the moment or by your personal affection for the writer. Still, I knew from the first page that this was special. It was all Chap, the best of him as I knew him, and other sides I'd never gotten a chance to know, including his love for Rose, which brought me to tears more than once. But best of all was its portrait of men and of the desert war. Chap's Englishmen and New Zealanders were by no means professional soldiers. They had not trained all their lives for war, as had many of their Axis enemies. Yet they rose to the occasion when necessity demanded. Chap's own story was that of a civilian who, under exigency's law, embraced the virtues of war and was transformed by them. Chap's memoir brought forward a second theme that was, to me, equally significant. This was the self-restraint, even chivalry, that distinguished the conduct of combatants on both sides throughout the North Africa campaign. Because the forces clashed in open desert, far from civilian population centers, there was little, if any, of what we call today collateral damage. The flat, vacant waste, coupled with the extreme nature of the elements and the terrain, lent a sort of purity to the conflict. Machine gunners routinely held their fire when enemy soldiers bailed out of disabled tanks. Stretcher bearers were permitted to dash into the open to evacuate the wounded. In frontline dressing stations, wounded men of Axis and Allied armies often received treatment side by side. On no few occasions, from German and British medical officers working shoulder to shoulder. The leading exemplar of this code was Rommel himself. When orders from Hitler mandated the execution of captured British commandos, Rommel tossed the document into the trash. He insisted that Allied prisoners receive the same rations and medical care as he himself was given. He even wrote a book about the conflict called Krieg ohne Hass, which translates as War Without Hate. Memoirs of the North Africa campaign attest that, fierce and brutal as much of the fighting was, relations between individual enemies retained a quality of forbearance that seems today almost impossible to imagine. This chapter is the introduction to Chap's memoir. The full document follows. It was my decision not to render the text into American English, but to leave it in the mother tongue as Chap wrote it. I have edited it slightly for U.S. readers and have added a brief epilogue whose aim is to bring up to date the lives and deaths of the officers and men Chap wrote about since the time he completed his pages. To avoid using footnotes or a glossary, I have taken the liberty of blending into the text as unobtrusively as possible clarifications for such Englishisms or shorthand as Chap occasionally employed. For example, military acronyms such as KDG for the King's Dragoon Guards, an armored car regiment. Where period slang appears, I've tried to shape the surrounding text so that the meaning is clear, or at least decipherable from the context. These alterations accepted, the final text remains as close to Chap's original as I could make it. Book 1. An Englishman. Chapter 1. During the final months of 1942 and the early weeks of 1943, it was my extraordinary fortune to take part in an operation behind enemy lines whose aim was to locate and kill Field Marshal Erwin Rommel, Commander-in-Chief of German and Italian forces in North Africa. The operation, the term raid, was never employed, was authorized by Lieutenant General Bernard Law Montgomery, commanding 8th Army, planned by the office of Lieutenant Colonel John Shan Hackett of G Raiding Force, and carried out by elements of Lieutenant Colonel David Sterling's SAS, the Special Air Service, reinforced by irregular troopers of Major Vladimir Penyakov's No. 1 Demolition Squadron, more familiarly known as Popsky's Private Army, as well as officers and other ranks of the Long Range Desert Group. The operation placed its hopes of success not in firepower, since its heaviest vehicles were unarmored 1.5-ton Chevrolet trucks, packing no armament bigger than 50-caliber aircraft Brownings and 20-millimeter Breda guns, but on cunning, audacity, and surprise. Attempts on Rommel's life had been made before. These, however, had struck at lightly defended rear areas to which their target had withdrawn temporarily for rest or recuperation. The operation in which I took part aimed to strike at the heart of the German Africa Corps in the field. If this scheme sounds driven by desperation, it was. At the moment of the operation's initial planning, summer 1942, Rommel and Panzer Armee Africa had just finished routing the British Eighth Army in a series of battles in the western desert. German armour had driven our tanks and men across all Libya, over the Egyptian frontier to the very gates of Alexandria. Churchill had just sacked the army's commanders. In Cairo, the code books were being burned. Rommel stood one push from Suez and the Middle East oil fields. Russia was then reeling under attack from 166 Nazi divisions. With Arab oil, Hitler's war machine could break the Red Army's back. Nor would rescue quickly come from America. The US had barely entered the war. Full mobilization lay months away. The Allies were staring global defeat in the face. Could a commando raid in North Africa make a difference? It could, the planners in Cairo believed, if it could eliminate Rommel. Rommel was the heart and soul of Axis forces in the desert. The Jerrys have no general who can replace him. This was Major Jake Easonsmith, our commander, speaking at the initial briefing. Kill him, and the beast dies. But could such a strike succeed? It might, paradoxically, because of Rommel's own personal bravery and his audacious style of command. The Desert Fox led from the front. His mode of leadership was to place himself physically wherever the action was hottest, heedless of his own safety. "Rommel isn't reckless," declared Easonsmith. "He has simply found that in mobile warfare the commander's presence at the point of action is essential." Rommel was notorious among his own junior officers, we were told, for materialising unannounced at forward positions, stepping down from his Fiesler-Storch scout plane or his mammoth armoured command vehicle, occasionally from a tank or a staff car, or even a motorcycle upon which he had hitched a ride. It was not exceptional for Rommel to issue orders directly to his regimental commanders, or even, in the heat of the moment, to take personal command of units as small as infantry companies. Such boldness had nearly got Rommel killed more than once. He set his plane down by accident one time amongst an Allied formation and winged away barely, with bullets whizzing round his head. Another time, he escaped capture when he ran out of fuel on the frontier wire, again amidst Commonwealth troops. Rommel was rescued a third time by the staff car carrying one of his own generals who happened, emulating his mentor, to be as far forward as Rommel was. Rommel's trademark aggressiveness, it was hoped, could render him vulnerable to a surprise thrust. If Allied raiders could use the deep desert routes to move undetected into the German rear, if they could manoeuvre forward undiscovered, if they could fix Rommel's position, if a skilled and daring party could do all this, they might be able to land a blow that would change the course of the war. My name is Chapman, Richmond Lawrence. In September 1942, I was a lieutenant in the 22nd Armoured Brigade, 7th Armoured Division. I was a tank officer. I commanded, theoretically, a recce, or reconnaissance troop, of four A-15 Crusaders. I say theoretically because in action the turnover was so swift and violent, both from enemy fire and from mechanical breakdowns, that a troop could be down to two tanks, or even one of its original kind, then reconstituted overnight with different types fresh from the repair depots. American Grants, British Crusaders, and the US-built aircraft-engined Stuarts that their crews called Honeys. Likewise, the men turned over. That is another story. The point for this tale is that, at that time, circumstances conspired to export me from the armoured division and translate me into the long-range desert group. My presence amongst this company was in a technical capacity only. I had been PTD'd, personnel temporarily detached, to the formation with an eye to assessing the going, over which the patrols would travel, meaning the terrain's suitability on future occasion to bear tanks and heavy transport. I was by no means the first tank officer so assigned. Advisers from the Royal Armoured Corps regularly hitchhiked on LRDG patrols for similar purposes. Royal Air Force officers did the same, scouting out potential landing grounds in the inner desert. The mission of the long-range desert group was raiding and reconnaissance in the enemy's rear. At the time I joined it, the unit operated in patrols of 5 or 6 trucks, with one officer and 15 to 20 men. Patrols were entirely self-contained, carrying all their own petrol, water, rations, ammunition, and spare parts. In addition to its own combat operations, the long-range desert group conveyed spies and agents on covert assignments and provided transport and navigation for assault parties of the SAS and other commando outfits. The group's greatest joy, however, was to work beat-ups, their slang term for attacks on enemy airfields, motor assembly areas and convoy routes. At the time of the British retreat to Alamein in summer of 1942, the LRDG had been in business for almost 2 years. Its raids had destroyed and damaged hundreds of Axis aircraft and caused thousands of German and Italian troops to be pulled out of the front lines and redeployed to provide rear area security. The formation had acquired a certain swashbuckling glamour. Volunteers queued by the hundreds. Getting in was no cinch, however. From one batch of 700 applicants, the LRDG took only 12. Criteria for selection were less wild and woolly than one might imagine. The group was not seeking buccaneers or assassins. What its officers wanted was the solid, mature sort, the type of chap who could think for himself under pressure, work in close quarters with others, and handle extremes not only of danger but of tedium, hardship and privation. The virtues of resourcefulness, self-composure, patience, hardiness, not to mention a sense of humour, were prized as highly as those of bravery, aggressiveness, and raw martial rigour. In this, I believe the LRDG was spot on. One of the factors that has kept me until now from writing of my own combat experiences is the uneasiness I have felt about the genre of war literature. Tales of heroes, the nobility of sacrifice, and so forth, have always made me uneasy. They run counter to my experience. From what I've seen, the operations of war are constituted less of glorious attacks and valiant defences, and more of an ongoing succession of mundane and often excruciating balls-ups. The patrol of which I write, typical of so many, achieved little heroic beyond its own survival, save at the very end, and then less by military or tactical brilliance than by luck and its protagonist's stubborn, even mulish refusal to quit. Those actions of its men that may legitimately claim the name of gallantry came about largely from attempts at self-extrication from peril, most of which we got ourselves into by our own overzealousness, and the main of which were performed either in the heat of instinct or the frenzy of blood terror. The men who performed these heroics often could not recall them in the aftermath. Let me say this about courage under fire. In my experience, valour in action counts for far less than simply performing one's commonplace task without cocking it up. This is by no means as simple as it sounds. In many ways, it's the most difficult thing in the world. Certainly, for every glorious death memorialised in dispatches, one could count 20 others that were the product of fatigue, confusion, inattention, over or under assertion of authority, panic, timidity, hesitation, honest errors or miscalculations, mishaps and accidents, collisions, mechanical breakdowns, lost or forgotten spare parts, intelligence deficiencies, mistranslated codes, late or inadequate medical care, not to say bollocksed up orders or the failure to grasp and implement proper orders, misdirected fire from one's own troops or allies, and general all-around muddling, sometimes the fault of the dead trooper himself. The role of the officer, in my experience, is nothing grander than to stand sentinel over himself and his men, towards the end of keeping them from forgetting who they are and what their objective is, how to get there, and what equipment they're supposed to have when they arrive. Oh, and getting back. That's the tricky part. Such success as the long-range desert group enjoyed may be credited in no small measure to the superior leadership of Colonel Ralph Bagnold and Lieutenant Colonel Guy Prendergast, its founder and follow-on commanding officer, for whom the applications of preparation and thoroughness far surpass those of courage and intrepidity. Before being seconded to the long-range desert group, I served, as I said, with the 22nd Armoured Brigade of the 7th Armoured Division, the famous Desert Rats. Our regiment was brought forward from the Delta in April and May 1942 as replacement crews during the chaos of the battles of Gazala and the Cauldron. 22nd Armoured Brigade had begun the campaign as part of 1st Armoured Division, but was taken under command of 7th Armoured Division in the emergency. Her sister armoured regiments, which at that point had been reduced to composite formations, were the 3rd and 4th County of London Yeomanry and the 2nd Royal Gloucestershire Hussars. We too were a yeomanry regiment, that is, a home formation of the Territorial Army, cavalry recently mechanised and converted to armour. To the civilian, and to me as well before I became familiar with them, tanks appear to be invulnerable behemoths beneath the massive bulk of their armour, their great guns, and the deafening clamour of their engines. In reality, a tank is fragile as a flower. A 3-foot slit trench can snap a track. A too tight turn can shred the pins that link the treads. An armoured column guzzles petrol. Unreplenished, it can stay in action no more than 2.5 hours, less over rough going or at speed. The range of a British Matilda was 70 miles. Under battle conditions, American Stuarts had to fill up every 40. Tanks advance tethered to their B echelon vehicles, the lorries, thin skinners and ragtops that carry the petrol and rations, water, lubricants and ammunition, without which the armoured monsters they serve become nothing but clumsy and stationary targets. A tank depends utterly upon its supporting combat arms. Without infantry to protect its flanks and rear, to knock out anti-tank guns and to clear minefields, a tank is vulnerable to all manner of evils. Without artillery and anti-tank fire to shield it from the enemy's armour, without aircraft to sling bombs and cannon fire at the foe advancing outside its field of vision, the tank is a plum, a bullseye, a sitting duck. High explosive shells can junk its suspension and tracks. Armour-piercing rounds rip through its turret. Anti-tank guns can penetrate its armour at 2,000 yards. In a tank, fighter planes and bombers are on top of you before you can hear them. You're deaf and blind in a tank. The commander in a Crusader, or an American Grant, rides directly above the gearbox and engine, whose combined din screams at such ungodly volume that an enemy shell can explode 30 feet away and you can't even hear it. At speed, over uneven ground, the tank commander bangs and lurches within the cylinder of his cupola, eyes fixed to his field glasses, ears fastened to his headset, concentrating hour after hour not only upon the flats, hummocks, ravines, wadis, and dead ground of the desert on all sides of him, and of course upon the enemy manoeuvring, lurking and darting over it, but also, and without let-up, upon the crackling cacophony of his squadron and regimental wireless nets, over which come his orders and his relief, of which he must miss nothing, as his own life and those of his men depend on it. Then there's the heat. Captain James Mattoon, my original squadron leader and a mechanical engineer in civilian life, calculated that an external temperature of 10 degrees Celsius, 50 Fahrenheit, was ideal for a tank on the move. At 10 outside, you rode at 20 inside, 70 Fahrenheit. For every degree Fahrenheit rise outside, interior temperature rose a degree and a half. 70 out was 100 in. 90, 120. At 100 outside, and the thermometer reached and exceeded that every summer day in the desert, you were broiling inside at 135. Still, I loved tanks. I loved the armoured division. What I hated, what we all abhorred, were the vain and courage-crazy tactics which obsolete doctrine and our own under-gunned and under-armoured tanks compelled us to employ. While Rommel's Mark III and Mark IV Panzers advanced in self-covering leapfrogs, backed by crack motorized infantry and screens of lethal 88mm and 50mm anti-tank guns. Our crusaders, Grants and Honeys, found themselves again and again on their own, isolated and exposed. Outranged by 1,000 yards by the Mark IV's long-barreled 75s, and nearly as far by the Mark III's. Our squadrons had no alternative but to dash from one spot of cover to the next, when and if such sights could be discovered, seeking either to flank the foe or to charge at him head-on, usually across open ground, in a desperate attempt to get within gun range before he or his anti-tank screens turned us into flamers or brew-ups. The enemy reckoned this, of course, and exploited it with feigned retreats, flanking manoeuvres and ambushes into which we blundered time and again. The retreat to the Egyptian frontier in the summer of 1942 culminated for me in a fiasco on a sandy track alongside the Cairo-Mersa-Matruh rail line. My troop of 4 tanks had been reduced to 1 Crusader and 1 American Grant, our squadron having lost, over the preceding 21 days, no fewer than 19 others. Valentines, Honeys, A-10 and A-13 cruisers, even a pair of captured Italian M-13s. Some had been brought up from the repair shops as replacements, others salvaged intact or refitted in the field, along with their crews, who were cycled through so quickly owing to wounds, death or capture, that most barely learnt my name, and I theirs, before their place was taken by the next round, fresh from the pool companies. On the 21st day, I found myself separated from my squadron, who were a mile or two ahead, bottlenecked on the track west of Fuka in a 100-mile traffic jam. Still that distance short of Alexandria, with 100 more to Cairo. My wife, Rose, was a Navy telegrapher in Alexandria. She was pregnant with our first child. I was desperate to get her evacuated before Rommel and Panzer Armee Africa overran Egypt all the way to Suez. Suddenly I spotted a break in the column, with clear sailing ahead, cross-country, at least enough to get round the jam and rejoin my squadron. "Driver, hard right," I commanded. Off we rumbled, steamrolling a wire barrier, directly onto a Mark IV mine. No one was hurt, but my right track and front ventilator were blown to scratch. Under favourable conditions, the crew can refit a shed track by locking the steering on the unspool side, railway tracking spare plates beneath the spool side, then using the power of the still-shod track to inch forward over this newly cobbled sheath, while the fitters on the ground manhandle the heavy plates into position, replace the blown ones with spares, and repin them. That option was out of the question in the middle of a minefield. Meanwhile, the mortification grew more excruciating by the moment. Before the unstifled glee of several hundred onlooking officers and other ranks, I bailed out with my crew, intending to backtrack on foot out of the minefield, where I would take over my other, still mobile tank. The humiliation was unalleviated by the spectacle of driver, gunner, and wireless operator emerging from our tank, arms laden with tins of apricots, cigarettes and Italian ham, not to mention 6 bottles of boar's head gin, all looted on the retreat. Our regimental commander, a colonel with whom I had had a run-in several days earlier in the desert, chose this moment to appear on the shoulder of the track and, standing tall within the turret of his Grant, commanded me and my crew to return to our disabled tank and climb back aboard. He indicated a signboard poking up beside what was left of the wire. "I say, Lieutenant, can you read that posting?" I replied that I could. "What does it say?"
"It says minefield, sir."
"Whose minefield?"
"Ours, sir."
"Then what, upon Christ's twisted cross, are you doing in it?"
He demanded my name and outfit, though he knew both well, and instructed his adjutant by signal to write me up. I and my crew were to stay put until a squad of sappers could be called to carve us a way out. But I have got ahead of my story. I must reverse and set down the approach march, so to speak, without which this tale will make no sense to the reader or to me. If this were a work of fiction, and I its editor, I would urge the writer to dramatize such events as hold significance for the narrative's thesis. But I have no patience for such stuff in my own memoir, so the reader will forgive me, I hope, if I simply lay out the essentials overtly, as they were, and as they felt to me. Chapter 2. I am a product of the English public school system. I state this neither as a badge of honour nor as a blot of shame, only as a foundation in fact, from which I venture the thesis that this often nasty, brutish, and peculiarly British institution, whatever its other shortcomings, must be given credit for producing a type of citizen who came into his own during the war, in the officer corps of all theatres, but specifically, in my own experience, in the Western Desert. What is it about featureless wastes that appeals so powerfully to the Anglo-Saxon soul? William Kennedy Shaw, who served from its inception as intelligence officer of the long-range desert group, relates the tale of a captured German officer transported from Kufra to Cairo by one of the LRDG's patrols, nearly 700 miles in unarmoured Chevrolet trucks, across such appalling wilderness that even native Senussi tribesmen rarely dared venture into it. After several days of observing the long-range desert group's Tommies and Kiwis imperturbably at their labours, the prisoner confided to his captors, "We Germans could never pull off this trick as you do, wandering about on your own, miles from nowhere. We lack the individual initiative. We prefer to run in a pack." What appeared as unendurable hardship to soldiers of other nationalities produced a species of exhilaration in our lads raised on a diet of Kipling and institutional porridge. Sometime after the war, I ran into a school chum, a pilot, Flight Lieutenant S, who had been shot down over Holland in 1940 and had endured the better part of 4 years in Offlagluft 3, the most notorious of the camps for Allied flyers. When I asked him to describe the experience, he replied, "A bit like Marlborough, only with better breakfasts." The English educational system for the privileged classes of that era was made up of two tiers, public school and university. When war came, a third tier was appended, the regimental, so that a young man might be identified as, say, Harrow, Oxford, the Scots Greys, or Ampleforth, Cambridge, and the Guards. Which venues of passage cast or reinforced the graduate in a sliver of social hierarchy from which no earthly intervention could extract him? Old rich, newly ruined, anciently impoverished. My own family was old rich, freshly ruined on my father's side, and never rich at all on my mother's. At Winchester, when I was 13, there were 3 heating stoves, 2 half-sized baths, and 1 WC in a boarding house housing 30 boys. We used chamber pots at night. In winter, water froze in our drinking pitchers. Winchester boys were called commoners. We wore neckties in the classroom and caps and gowns on examination days. 20 cigarettes cost a shilling with a penny back in the packet. We read in Greek Xenophon's March of the 10,000, and in Latin, Livy's History of Rome, not to mention all of Chaucer, Milton, and Shakespeare, and the main freight of Marlowe, Coleridge, Hardy, Arnold, Tennyson, Thackeray, Dickens, and Conrad, while participating in all weathers in football, rugby, cricket, rowing, riding, and athletics, as well as attending religious services, usually Anglican, not once on Sunday, but 5 times a week. Many boys saw their parents on holidays only, some not even then. They raised each other like feral beasts, with all the outrages and excesses that such an upbringing implies. For most, it worked. The public schools of that era produced a type of young man who was keen but not academic, athletic but not muscle-bound, gay of heart and confident of mien, a solid chap, the sort who would sooner die than let the side down. Put another way, The system turned out the kind of individual who frequently displayed boredom or feckless complacency during times of prosperity, but shone through in hours of trial. I have often wondered of comrades who fell as heroes during the war whether, in the fatal instant, they weren't privately relieved to do so, dreading a deadly post-war normality more than the bullets and cannon shells of the foe. When I was 12, my mother was killed in a motor accident. I'm not a subscriber to the theory of traumatic psychopathology. It is humbug, in my view, to isolate some episode from childhood and extrapolate from it an aberration of character, indelible for the remainder of one's life. That said, some wounds go deep. My father, who had been driving at the time of the accident, suffered far worse than I. He could not overcome his grief and guilt. He withdrew, first from work, then from family, at last, by his own hand, from life itself. I have three sisters, Edna, Charlotte, and Margaret Anne. After the deaths of my mother and father, our two uncles, my father's brothers, in whose care we children were placed, thought it best that we be sent to boarding schools. My sisters were enrolled in St. Catherine's, an Anglican academy in Herefordshire, near the town of Hay-on-Wye. I was sent to Winchester. The night of my father's and mother's accident, my sisters and I were driven to the hospital by our neighbours in their 1924 Humber sedan, a car I adored because it had a jump seat in the back which folded up from the floor. My sisters disdained this as undignified, which was a joy to me as I got it all to myself. No one had told us yet what had happened or where we were going. We could scent the wind, however, and this cast a pall over the ride. My sisters were weeping already. At the hospital, a nurse instructed us to wait in an area of wooden benches. My sisters obeyed gravely. Our neighbours, an elderly couple, sat up with us. At the terminus of the hallway stood two wide, handleless doors, through which, from time to time, nurses pushed trolleys. On the far side of these, our mother lay in surgery. The doctors were labouring heroically, we were told, to save her. Our father's injuries were less severe. He was being treated in another wing. We waited. How long would the operation take? No one could tell us. Hours seemed to pass. Our caretakers would not let me go outside, so I excused myself to find the lavatory. I poked down a hallway. A passage opened onto a corridor of patients' rooms from which a nurse chased me. A dim space led to a kind of anteroom. I entered. In the corner sat a surgical trolley. On it was my mother's body. The bloody clothes from the accident had been wadded into a ball and dumped onto the trolley shelf below. My mother herself lay beneath a white surgical sheet which had fallen partly free, exposing her nakedness from waist to neck. She lay on her side, with her right arm dangling grotesquely. Her mouth was agape. She was already going stiff. No one was about. The institutional custodians had just left her there. A child sees and understands far more than grown-ups believe. I knew at once that this was death. My mother was gone. This inert object was not she. She was with Jesus or amongst the stars. I didn't believe any of that bollocks, but I repeated it to myself as I imagined I ought. I told myself I should not be angry. The hospital had many patients besides my mother whose needs were urgent. At times, the overtaxed staff had no alternative but to stick a dead person temporarily out of the way so that they could get on to other emergencies. The nurses would return soon, I was certain, and restore my mother to dignity. But I knew this was rubbish. I hated the authorities for leaving her like this, even for a moment. And I was furious with them for not telling my sisters and me. For how long did the hospital intend to hold us in suspense, believing that our mother might yet survive, when in truth her cold corpse had been dumped and forgotten upon this shameful siding?
I crossed to the trolley and repaired my mother's modesty. I worked the rings off her fingers and put them in my pocket. I didn't want the staff stealing them. My sisters told me later that I reappeared in the corridor in a state such as they had never seen. "Your face was scarlet," Edna said. "Tears were streaming down your cheeks." The surgeons, a young man and a senior, had just that moment emerged from the rear doors. Without a word, you sprinted the length of the hall and hurled yourself upon them, kicking and punching. In the end, my sisters told me, I had to be given a sedative and carried physically to the car. I have no recollection of that. What does remain with blazing clarity is this. My mother's death was my fault. I knew this instinctively and with every cell of my body. I had caused her end. How? By being too young and too small to protect her. Had I been driving the car instead of my father, no accident would have happened. Had I been with them, even as a passenger, somehow I would have preserved her, but I wasn't there. Because of my absence, my mother was dead. A child does not understand with reason. Later, at university, we studied Freud, Adler, and Jung. I could grasp intellectually the preposterousness of this childish belief, but rationality is powerless against emotion. Not long after that night, my uncle's influence got me into Winchester. Before then, I had never been in trouble at school. From that date, I was rarely out of it. I got into scrapes daily with the other boys and with the masters. I hated them all. I despised the school and every sham rite and cruel tradition it prided itself upon. The house I was assigned to was called Kingsgate. Each house had three prefects. These were sixth formers who received privileges in return for acting as counsellors and maintaining order. Our prefects were Talicot, Martin, and Zachary Stein. Stein was a Jew. Rumour declared him a poet. I knew only that he was tall and rich and spent a lot of time in his room. He had an American Schwinn bicycle with an illustration of a red Indian on the chain guard, which he rode in all weathers. I came in with two other boys whose names I forget. We were all 13. The older youths at once gave us the treatment. I had no experience of boarding school and was not prepared for this. In addition, I was both a muley, an orphan, and a duff, a hardship case, meaning I inhabited the absolute basement of the pecking order. The other two new boys alternated between rage and despair as each new indignity was heaped upon us. They hated the older boys and burned with murderous fantasies. That, or worshipped them shamelessly, I would do neither. I held in contempt the seniors who inflicted these abuses upon us. They perceived this, of course, and gave it to me twice over. By then, I was having a recurring nightmare. In the dream, I found myself beside a lake at twilight. A mist stood on the water. My mother's body lay on a barge, swathed in silk and flowers. Her eyes were closed, hands folded across her breast. Yet I was certain she was alive. Suddenly the barge was either pushed or began to move of its own accord, away from shore and into the mist, which I understood to mean oblivion. I had to save her. In a state of desperation, I plunged into the lake, hands stretching for the boat to pull it back. A great weight of iron, a garment of some kind, dragged me down. My mother's sleeping form slipped from my grasp. I woke in a state of dread and consternation. The culmination of the initiation ordeals at Winchester is a rite called the freeze-out. This was a tradition at the school. Upon a bitterly frigid night, we new boys were stripped of mufflers and overcoats and locked out in the storm. We had been told by one of the more kindly sixth formers that the torture would not last all night. The seniors would observe us in secret. When we had turned blue enough to satisfy the demands of the trial, they would fetch us back indoors. My fellow sufferers clung together, overacting their misery. I despised them.
I would not give our tormentors the satisfaction. I began walking. I was going home. I made my way to the railway station. The place was deserted. I set off down the tracks. How far I marched, I don't know. At some point, I lay down in the snow. Stein, the prefect, saved me. He told me later he had sensed the freeze-out coming, but had been fooled by the other boys, who had made pillow dummies of me and the other two, and had put them in our beds. Stein didn't realize what had happened till the frozen pair were brought back indoors. How did he find me? From my tracks in the snow and his own imagination. The train station? Home? He was a poet. He could figure it out. I was lying on my side on the tracks when I heard the tinny bell of Stein's American Schwinn. Chapman, where in damnation are you? I had never heard an upperclassman employ such language. Stein pedalled up. He was frightened. He thought I was dead. He wrapped me in a woolen blanket. Close behind him came the master's assistant in an ancient Peugeot. The assistant pulled up on the road that paralleled the tracks. Stein carried me through the woods to the car. "You better not pop off, you little sod," the master's assistant said as he bundled me through the passenger door and up against the machine's feeble heater. Stein wrapped me in the blanket and his own greatcoat, cursing when the assistant botched the clutch and stalled. "Is this little twit going to croak?" the fellow demanded. Stein produced a silver flask. "He'll be fine," he said, lifting the whiskey to my lips. "He just wants a stiff belt." Chapter 3. At Oxford, Stein was my tutor. For those unfamiliar with the tutorial system, it works like this. A student at university acquires his education by attending lectures and seminars given by dons. Attendance is voluntary. Theoretically, you could duck every lecture, as some did, myself amongst them, passing the hours playing croquet on the lawns behind Magdalen, my college, and still graduate with a first. But you must be examined and demonstrate mastery of the material. To assist the student in this, the university assigns him a tutor. Tutors are usually shaggy, ill-groomed junior dons who smoke and drink to excess and never leave their rooms except for illicit sexual liaisons or to replenish their stocks of tobacco and spirits. A good tutor can make one's college experience a revolutionary passage, to life as well as to literature. A bad one can make it misery. The college provides accommodations for each tutor, usually in double suites with another tutor. Stein's rooms were actually at Trinity College, where he was pursuing his own doctorate, with a kitchen and bath WC, two sleeping rooms, and a sitting room between. The latter was invariably a hellhole, overheated in winter to a point barely shy of combustion, and knee-deep in texts, papers, and the usual detritus of the academic life. I loved Stein's sitting room. It was the first home I'd had since my mother died. I went up to Oxford because of Stein. His letters and testimonials got me in. Stein had 8 or 9 other pupils, among whom was Alan Jock McCall of Goldsby, Sutherland. Jock became my closest friend. In those days, to be an all-round fellow was the ideal. Jock was that, a crack-quarter miler, brilliant essayist, undergraduate editor of the Charwell in his second year, an unheard-of honour, though I abhorred his politics, which were thoroughly military and imperialist. Jock's sister Rose became my bride, to whom I have been blissfully wed for more than 30 years. But again, I'm getting ahead of my story. Stein was 5 years my senior. He was 24 when I arrived at Oxford, and already a published poet. Beyond his own studies in Milton, in which field he was known even then as an authority, he was working on a novel. This impressed me even more. Stein refused to show pages to anyone or even to reveal his subject. Rumours, however, declared it homoerotic and political. "So," Jock used to ask me as he arrived for his tutorial immediately after mine,
What have you and Oscar Wilde been chatting about today?
Stein's tone towards me was one of affectionate irony. He teased me constantly, usually over my black Irish, meaning the moodiness that descended upon me with such regularity, and which I had acquired, Stein speculated, from my Irish mother. Stein had a theory that there was a difference between Jewish despair and Irish despair. Jewish despair arises from want and can be cured by surfeit. Give a penniless Jew 50 quid and he perks right up. Irish despair is different. Nothing relieves Irish despair. The Irishman's complaint lies not with his circumstances, which might be rendered brilliant by labour or luck, but with the injustice of existence itself. Death. How could a benevolent deity gift us with life, only to set such a cruel term upon it? Irish despair knows no remedy. Money can't help. Love fades. Fame is fleeting. The only cures are booze and sentiment. That's why the Irish are such noble drunks and glorious poets. No one sings like the Irish or mourns like them. Why? Because they're angels imprisoned in vessels of flesh. When I told Stein of my recurring nightmare, his immediate question was, "What garment of iron are you wearing that drags you down?" When I described it, he said at once, "Armour." I had never thought of that. Stein's conclusion was that I was at heart a knight, and that the mystery of my life could never be solved without taking into account the centrality of that vocation. Stein lifted my gloom. His example gave me permission to seek my truest self. He assigned me readings far beyond the scope of university instruction. With Jock and others, we talked of literature for hours. Under Stein's tutelage, I blossomed both as a writer and as a critic of writing. I lost my fear of seeming smart, of standing out or appearing different. Amongst the many qualities I admired in Stein, foremost was his refusal to be anything other than who he was. In those days, to be a homosexual, even in a university setting, was something one dared not speak of. It was against the law. You could go to prison. Certainly your career could be impeded. Stein didn't give a damn.
"A Jew, a poet, and a poof," he declared of himself. "The hat trick of social undesirability."
Once, in the dining hall, Jock and I got into a row over Stein. Jock respected Stein but avoided him in public. A too close association, he believed, could do harm to one's standing.
"Balls," I told him. "Stein's keener than half these bloody dons. He's twice the writer, works 3 times as hard. He's the only one who actually takes time for his pupils, and he's got the belly to speak his mind, unlike these other careerist bootlickers."
Stein's politics were left and radical. He was wildly rich. I visited the family estate once in the West Riding of Yorkshire. The grounds covered 700 acres. Stein was related to the Rothschilds on his father's side. His mother was descended from Benjamin Disraeli's niece. The family fortune came from wool. The Lederers, Stein's mother's family, owned mills at Bradford, Leeds and Bingley. Stein's great-grandfather Hyman had pioneered the concept of the factory village. He provided housing, education and medical care for his workers, of a standard surpassing anything of the time. His essay, On the Perfectibility of Human Nature, was required reading in my natural sciences course. In those days at Oxford, the social roost was ruled by an elect spawned of the wealthiest and most ancient families, who possessed or affected the following constellation of virtues: athletic prowess, especially if acquired without apparent effort, capacity for alcohol, reckless physical daring, particularly involving horses, heights, or motor cars, contempt for all affairs of religion, politics, or commerce, and a withering disdain for academia and academic achievement. The scions of this elite by no means despised Hitler. Many applauded the Munich Pact of 1938. They viewed with scorn the red opponents of appeasement. In their eyes, Churchill was little better, an arch-conservative jingoist and warmonger. I hated these bastards. So did Stein. At Winchester, he had been famous for abhorring the 20th century. He refused to learn to drive. He believed in reincarnation. Asked what religion he followed, he answered, Hindu. He spoke and read French, German, and Italian, and could translate classical Greek and Latin as fast as he could read them. The more anti-Semitism he observed in government and in the press, however, the more he identified with his co-religionists and the more outspoken he became on their behalf. He penned letters to the editor. He wrote checks to all sorts of causes. By the time I reached Oxford, Stein was reading 6 newspapers a day. I know because he sent me down to the newsagent to pick them up. Stein demonstrated with the communists outside Parliament. He was arrested. In the late 30s, as I said, there was tremendous pro-German and pro-National Socialist feeling in England. Stein's hair was too long, his dress too unkempt. He was not the right sort. Rumours began. Stein laughed them off, declaring that such calumnies were the same as those levelled against Socrates, inventing new gods and corrupting the young. Stein's downfall came about because of an undergraduate I shall call B. B, a fine rugby wing, became a Royal Marine and was killed piloting an assault craft at Gold Beach on D-Day, 6th of June, 1944. B fell in love with Stein, but he never told him. He confined his passion to entries in his private diary, no doubt terrified of the consequences should he dare act upon his impulses. Somehow, B's father, a prominent solicitor, learned of this. The next thing anyone knew, 2 police inspectors appeared at Stein's door. Stein assumed that his offence was connected to his activities on behalf of refugee Jews. "It's the Amendment Act," said the officers. This was a charge of gross indecencies and solicitation of unnatural vice. Stein was arrested for having seduced a boy he had never met. In the end, the charges were dropped for want of evidence. Not, however, before Stein had become notorious. In those days, such a scandal might have been weathered by a tenured don. For a tutor, it was fatal. Worse were the consequences for Stein's novel. B's father, it seems, was not content with running Stein out of Oxford.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.